My iPhone says we're early, but we're going to start since everybody's so attentive and in their seats. I'm Barry Friedman, and this is the forum. And we are doing this forum on an issue that, you know, I know what everybody else knows out there in the world, which is obviously Congress needs to do something about the Bush-era tax cuts. It's afraid to do it before the election, so they've sort of told us what they're going to do, but they haven't done it, so nobody can run advertisements about that. We have an amazing panel to talk about it, so I'm going to do my usual practice, which is to introduce the panel, and then we'll get going. We'll go up here for about a half an hour, and then, as usual, we'll turn matters over to you. I want to remember to make my announcement that I always forget, which is that we are taping this, so if you do not want to be recorded, then you should not stand up to ask a question. And having said that, let me do the introduction. So to my immediate right is Dan Shaviro, my dear colleague. Dan teaches the tax courses here, including the Tax Colloquium, which I think is one of the toughest and best tax shows in the country. And Dan has written many books on this subject and also a novel called Getting It, about which I'm very impressed. And Dan is going to go first. To my right is Diane Lim Rogers, to my left, sorry. That's why Dan's here, to keep me straight on my right and my left. Both Diane and Alan have graced us by having worked in both branches of the federal government. There only being two branches of the federal government when it comes to tax, the executive and the legislative branches. Diane now is with the Concord Coalition, which is a public interest group dedicated to grassroots advocacy about fiscal responsibility. That's a sell, though I commend it. And she's also one of the bloggers on Economist Moms, so I recommend that you check that out. And finally, to my far left is Alan Viard, who is at the American Enterprise Institute. Again, he and Diane both have been in the legislative and executive branches. And Alan has the distinction of having been a nominee for last year for Tax Person of the Year, something I've always aspired to, but fear is never going to happen for me. So with that, we will start.
Okay, thanks, Barry, and thanks to all of you for coming. So I know the lunch on tax may not be what you thought you were going to do a month ago, but well, a number of the tax cuts adopted close to 10 years ago had 2010 expiration dates. These include rate reductions throughout the income tax schedule, including lowering the top bracket from 39.6% to 35%. Others that we won't discuss today up front but can address in the question period include temporary repeal of the estate tax and creating a special 15% tax rate for dividends. Now, for NBA fans, in honor of the season that just began, my aim today is to be Jason Kidd, not Stephon Marbury. In other words, I want to set up my panel colleagues to score rather than trying to take the big shots myself. But let me say what I believe will be today's main takeaway for many of you. My two fellow commentators, one is relatively liberal and one is relatively conservative. But you may end up being surprised by two things. The first is the extent to which they agree with each other. And the second is the extent to which they do not agree with what politicians on either side of the aisle are saying. Now, I see three key facts for today's discussion for thinking about extending the Bush tax cuts. First, we're either in recession or just out of it with a danger of severe relapse. Either way, unemployment is much too high. So I believe the economy needs further stimulus if this can be done effectively. Allowing tax rates to increase would be the opposite of stimulus. But extending the tax cuts is poorly designed as stimulus, and concern about the state of the economy would only support extending them temporarily. Second point, we're on an unsustainable fiscal path with projected spending way ahead of projected revenues. Taxes will have to go up. Spending growth, in particular healthcare related, will have to slow. Otherwise, we'll eventually have a fiscal crisis, potentially leading to both a severe depression and hyperinflation that'll make what happened 2 years ago look like a walk in the park. Now, given our unsustainable fiscal path, I'd say it verges on insanity to consider extending any of the rate cuts more than temporarily, unless the extension is financed and then some by other changes that include raising taxes in some other way instead. Yet the Democrats and Republicans both want to extend unsustainable tax cuts, and they only disagree about extending the top bracket. The third key point, I think, is that in the last 20 years, there's been a big change in U.S. wealth distribution. In particular, if you go not just to the 99th percentile, but to the upper portion of that, you'll observe substantial relative gains compared to everyone else. Why this happened and how bad it is, if it's bad at all, is disputed, as well as what, if anything, to do about it, but it is a fact. Now, it's agreed as well that addressing increased wealth inequality through higher income tax rates at the top is likely to be more costly in efficiency terms per dollar of tax revenue obtained than allowing tax cut rates to increase further down on the income scale. But Diane and Alan may disagree about how costly it is and about the costs versus benefits of getting more revenues from tax revenues from people at the very top. Well, that's really all I have to say for now, but I'm hoping Diane and Alan will address the following questions. One is, do you agree with the summary I've offered, and is there anything you disagree with? Second is, if you personally got to decide what will happen to the expiring individual rate cuts but nothing else, what would you do? And the third is, what else should we do, including to what extent would you try to get more revenue from people at the very top of the distribution, and if you did try, how would you propose to do it?
Thank you, Dan. That was cheery. a good, happy start. Diane?
I can't promise that I'll cheer you up any more than Dan just did, but I'm an economist. I'm trained as an economist who studies tax policy issues, the structure of the U.S. tax system primarily, and the economic effects of tax policy on individual and business behavior. And so my critique of the Bush tax cuts comes from that economics perspective. Whatever I say in my opening remarks reflects my economics background and no political reality. So I'll start with sort of why the Bush tax cuts, in my opinion, are not good economic policy. The reason they're being debated and the fight is mainly about who can propose to extend more of the Bush tax cuts, that fact is a political reality. I have no offers of solutions to the problem we're faced in terms of the bidding war that both sides of the aisle seem to be on in terms of deficit spending, whether it be on the tax side or the spending side of the budget. So back in 2001, when the Bush tax cuts were passed, the primary reason that they were justified or pitched at the time was because we were running very large budget surpluses. And there was actually a concern out there that we might pay down the federal debt too fast. Seriously. And Alan Greenspan testified before Congress in a very... It was a hugely significant testimony.
There are seats up front. There are seats over here. There's lots of seats on this side. So if you're looking for seats, we got lots of them. Sorry.
Alan Greenspan testified that it was a good idea to pass a big tax cut, mainly because we were running big surpluses and it would be more efficient to return the money to the private sector. Back in 2001, at the very end of the Clinton administration, we actually knew already that we would have a long-term challenge because the baby boom generation has been around for a long time. They're the group of people that were born between 1946 and 1964, and there are more of us than any of you, younger folks, and than any of our parents' generation. So we were a huge swell in the population. The problem with that from a federal budget, federal government perspective, is that we have a lot of government programs that go disproportionately, the benefits go disproportionately to retirement age people, retired people. So, and we also tend to pay for those programs on a largely pay-as-you-go basis, meaning that we use revenues coming in that are collected from current workers to pay for benefits that are going out to current retirees. So that's all well and fine as long as there's sort of an evenness in the population and the cohorts of the population coming through the system. But when you have a swell in the population, even when they're young, you can sort of see off in the future that this isn't going to work for too long, that once this huge population gets to retirement age, we're going to have much more pressure on the Social Security and Medicare budget. So those are our two big federal programs that go where benefits go primarily to retirement age people. In 2001, we were told that we could afford the Bush tax cuts. We were actually technically told we could afford the Bush tax cuts only if they expired before the end of the 10-year budget window. So we built in place this artificial sunset of the tax law so that all the Bush tax cuts would go away magically on December, at the end of December 31st, 2010, which is coming up. The original justification was we were running surpluses. We had the money to give away. Why not give it back to the private sector? Well, it became clear very early on that we weren't going to have so much money to give away, that the projections of revenues coming in were rosier than was justified, that we did fall into a recession much milder than the one we're just coming out of, but we were in a recession during 2001. We also did not anticipate, we did not think about the cost of wars that were in our future, the cost of Katrina that would be in our future. There were a lot of things that put pressure on the federal budget. But no matter what circumstance came up that might have adjusted our perspective on whether the Bush tax cuts were affordable or not, we came up with new reasons as to why the Bush tax cuts were such a good idea. So when we fell into recession, we needed the Bush tax cuts because they were good stimulus to the economy. So they changed from being a good pro-growth tax policy to one that was supposed to be good stimulus. When we came out of the mild recession in 2001 and got back to a normal level of economic growth, the Bush tax cuts were justified once again as being good for longer-term economic growth. So we've been switching back and forth between why is the reason that we need the Bush tax cuts. Today, back in the Clinton administration, at the end of the administration, we were saying in I was on the Council of Economic Advisors staff at writing the last economic report of President Clinton. We said we couldn't afford the tax cuts back then, even with surpluses. The Clinton administration's position was that we needed to be building up surpluses because we knew the retirement of the baby boom generation was just around the corner. We knew that we had to have a little cushion in place in case we faced some rainy days in the future, things like wars, natural disasters. These are all things that are actually mentioned in our last Clinton economic report of the president. We weren't being clairvoyant. It's just that you can pretty much count on these things coming up every now and then, things that put pressure on the budget that you haven't built in and anticipated. Today, we're faced with a situation where we obviously are doing a lot of deficit spending, and that's because we have just come out of the biggest recession since the Great Depression. And yet, the Bush tax cuts are being proposed as a way of addressing both short-term weakness in the economy and the need to get to a stronger, longer-term economy that will eventually help the budget outlook, the federal budget outlook, with stronger economic growth. My position on these tax cuts is they're not the best policy for either short-term stimulus or for longer-term economic growth. They're not the best policy for short-term stimulus because they're not very well targeted at households who do the most consumption spending. It's a well-known empirical fact that higher-income households save more of their income than lower income households do. When we're talking about short-term stimulus, we're talking about the need to encourage people to go out and buy goods and services immediately. So the Bush tax cuts are very skewed to the higher income households. They've always been quite skewed. But you know, even if we let the highest bracket tax cuts expire and extend the rest of the brackets and all the rest of the Bush tax cuts, the child tax credit, the marriage penalty relief, even the rest of the Bush tax cuts, leaving aside the top two brackets, the disproportionate share of the dollar value of the tax cuts still goes to the highest income households because highest income households benefit the most from rate reductions even at the bottom because they pass their income passes through all those lower level brackets. So they get the maximum benefit from those. So they're not good for short-term stimulus. They're not good for longer-term stimulus either because the biggest problem with our tax system in terms of being economically inefficient is the fact that our income tax base is so wildly uneven. It's full of holes. It's sort of the Swiss cheese income tax base. So it's full of holes, and it's uneven. It's a very unlevel playing field. And because we have such a narrow base, narrow tax base. We have to impose higher marginal tax rates just to raise a given amount of revenue. We create bigger distortions between those activities that are taxed and those that are not included in the tax base. And so for economic efficiency, we shouldn't be just talking about raising or lowering marginal tax rates whenever we need less or more revenue. We should be talking about what can we do to make the tax base more efficient? What can we do to broaden the tax base? So the Bush tax cuts did not do very well in that regard. President Obama has proposed to extend most of the Bush tax cuts, despite the fact that President Obama blames the Bush tax cuts for most of the fiscal mess we're in. He repeatedly talks about how it was the fiscal irresponsibility of the fiscally irresponsible Bush tax cuts and the Medicare prescription drug program that put us on this unsustainable path. And yet, he's not proposing to change it very much. He is proposing to extend about over $2 trillion worth in terms of the 10-year cost out of maybe $2.7 trillion of the entirety of the Bush tax cuts. So President Obama is dealing with a campaign promise he made, where he promised to not raise taxes on anyone under $250,000 of income, try to make the tax system more efficient and raise more revenue from it with that constraint. It's impossible. And so President Obama's also made a pledge that he wants to get the deficit under control. He's appointed a fiscal commission to make recommendations to get the deficit down to 3% of GDP by 2015. And I'm here to tell you that there's no way that he can keep both of those promises. So one of those promises is going to be broken. Either he's going to have to change his mind about raising taxes on most Americans, because most Americans are going to have to pay more in taxes, or he's going to have to give up trying to get the deficit to an economically sustainable level. So I'll be happy to address more of what the commission might be able to do in the Q&A. Thanks.
Well, thanks. As Dan said, there is quite a bit of agreement between me and Diane, as I think you'll see, maybe a few areas of disagreement or difference in emphasis. In some ways, it's not surprising, maybe. Diane is here on behalf of the Concord Coalition. I'm not here on behalf of the Concord Coalition, but I am a member of the coalition and a contributor to it. Used to be active in the Ohio chapter of it in a former life. Still very concerned about the deficit and the issues that have been discussed here. Let me begin by just sketching briefly four long-term fiscal realities that I outlined in an article last year in Business Economics, the publication of the National Association of Business Economists. The first reality is that entitlement spending will need to be restrained relative to its current law path. Under current law, entitlement spending, especially healthcare entitlements, grows absolutely explosively. There's no way with any reasonable tax system of any kind that we can finance all of that growth that is built into current law. So politically difficult though it will be, there will have to be some restraint of that growth. The growth will not be as great as current law would provide for. The second reality, however, is that revenues will rise as a share of GDP relative to the levels that prevail today and the levels that have prevailed in the recent past. And some people object to that conclusion because they say that it is mathematically and even economically possible to hold revenues at their current level and to just do extremely severe entitlement restraint. But that is, I think, not politically viable. That's not what the American people are looking for. And a number of sources of evidence demonstrate that. I, in my article, cited a poll that was taken by Alan Blinder and Alan Krueger. Results are in the Brookings Papers on Economic Activity in 2004. They asked Americans just about Social Security, and its imbalance is actually, in the long run, modest compared to the imbalance that Medicare and Medicaid and some of the provisions of the new healthcare programs are. But what they asked people was, what would be your preferred way of addressing the Social Security imbalance? Would you like to rely primarily on payroll tax increases, or primarily on benefit cuts, or on a mixture of the two, a combination of the two? Well, 5% said that they would like to rely primarily on benefit cuts, so a very low number. 30% said they would rely mainly on payroll tax increases, and 34% said a mix of the two measures. Some people just absolutely refuse to choose any of the options, so I guess that's, and how many of them are in Congress, I don't know, but the ones who don't decide maybe in Congress, the 5% who want to rely mainly on benefit cuts, you know, that's like me and my colleagues at the American Enterprise Institute. But I think that politically you have to face the reality here, and especially even if we were to resolve the Social Security imbalance primarily through benefit cuts, which I would favor, it's not going to be realistic to do that for the much larger medical imbalance, I think, where it's you've got to mix the entitlement restraint with tax increases. So taxes will be going up as a share of GDP. That's the second reality. The third reality is that consumption taxation will become a larger part of the federal tax system as the revenues rise. There's a number of ways that could happen. The most attractive way, to my mind, but the most unlikely, is that the entire income tax system would be replaced by a progressive consumption tax, such as the Bradford X tax or the personal expenditures tax, and we can discuss that later if people want. The more likely outcome, but somewhat less appealing, is that the value-added tax would replace part of the income tax system, and there's ample international precedent for that. The fourth reality is that the middle class, broadly defined in the way that politicians define it, as going up to 200,000 or 250,000, the middle class, broadly defined, will bear most of the burden of closing the fiscal gap, whether that be done through the entitlement reductions or through tax increases. So with that background, let me just turn to the Bush tax cuts. And I guess it's easier for me to describe the wrong path that I think we're headed on than to say exactly what maybe we should do. I believe that the proposal that President Obama and the congressional Democrats have put forward is actually, in many respects, the worst of both worlds. Because as Diane mentioned, of course, the president would extend the majority of the Bush tax cuts, those going to people under 200,000 for singles, 250,000 for couples, but then would allow most of the tax cuts for the higher income groups to expire. That combination gives you much of the economic disincentives, the saving and investment and work penalties that you would get from allowing all of the Bush tax cuts to expire. But it also gives you much of the deficit increase that you would get from continuing all of them. Because what the president has done is to choose for extension those the component of the tax cuts that has the least effect on incentives relative to revenue loss. And I have an article in the AI Tax Policy Outlook in September that discusses this in more depth. I won't have time to go through it all here, but I think we've reached this outcome because of positions taken by the Republican Party, at least as much as the Democrats. You know, Diane said that the tax cuts have at times been marketed as ways to promote long-run growth. And I mean, I think that's true to some extent, that of course there have been people saying we want to do this for long-run growth because having these lower tax rates eases the penalties on saving and investment. But that's always actually been a minor part of the push for the tax cuts. As I discuss in my article, the main push for the tax cut simply was that it would increase the disposable income of the middle class. And that proved to be a very popular way to get this through. President Bush, in fact, at one point stood in front of a large cardboard check made out to U.S. taxpayer for $1,600 and said the typical family would get $1,600 of disposable income from these tax cuts. Well, you know, good enough. That's a good political strategy. It helped get the tax cuts adopted. It had a lot of implications. One is that you could not, one is the design of the tax cuts, that you had the majority of them going in the form of middle-class tax cuts that had limited effect on economic incentives. The second issue was that having marketed the tax cuts on the grounds that it increases the disposable income of the middle class, you cannot turn around and then say, let's cut middle-class entitlements. And indeed, the Bush administration did not turn around and say, let's cut middle-class entitlements. They created a new one, the Medicare prescription drug benefit. So it really, I think, proved to be a counterproductive method of getting the tax cuts passed from the standpoint of economic growth, because you had deficit finance tax cuts that were not well targeted on incentives. And it also laid no lasting groundwork for the rate cuts at the top that have the biggest incentive effects. It left the field wide open for someone to step forward and say, okay, you said the middle class tax cuts are the big part of this. You had your $1,600 cardboard check. So if that's the part that's so great, that's the part you always talk about, well, why don't we just keep that? You never really told us any reason to have the rate cuts at the top, so let's get rid of those. Well, so that was an opening, and of course, President Obama has seized upon that and said, you know, let's just keep the middle class part. And I believe that is what's going to happen when the dust clears, although there could be a temporary extension for a year or two. So what should we do if this is the worst of both worlds, and if that is not what we should do, you know, what should we do? You know, I'm not certain. I think that a reporter recently made a comment to me that the Republicans seem to have won the tax war because they, we've got now this agreement that the majority of the Bush tax cuts should be made permanent. And I guess that may be right, but I said, well, I wonder then what it is exactly we've won, what the Republicans have won, because what we've got here is tax cuts that are not well suited to provide incentives for economic growth. So I guess my position would be that if we were to have any extension of the Bush tax cuts, it should include the provisions at the top, and I think that we, of course, certainly don't need to do a full extension, and I think in view of our fiscal situation, we cannot. In January 2007, my position actually was that we should not extend any of the Bush tax cuts unless there was an offset in the form of other tax increases or entitlement reductions. In some sense, I actually think that is still the right position, but politically it no longer seems viable. I think that what may be better is a partial extension of some of the middle class tax cuts and some of the tax cuts at the top, but try to limit the fiscal damage while preserving some of the incentive effects. Obviously, as we move beyond the Bush tax cuts, we will have to deal with those fiscal realities, the need to move towards consumption taxation in some form, the need to raise revenues as a share of GDP, the need to restrain entitlements, and the need to put burdens on the middle class. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. That's terrific. All of you have been great. I thought since Dan was so wonderfully short on the front end, if he wanted a couple of minutes to comment on the responses of the other two, I'd offer that up.
Well, again, I think there's, as you saw, there is some amount of agreement, again, I want to emphasize really the extraordinary disconnect between what any fair-minded expert knows and what you hear the politicians saying. I've written like a couple of books about things like budget deficits and like that. Whenever I talk to people about it, say like how bad the long-term situation is, it's striking how these people who are not experts in the subject nonetheless completely know the bottom line already. It's not like they're learning it from me for the first time. Everyone kind of knows that our country is headed to a very dangerous fiscal place, and yet any politician who tries in the slightest to address it is committing political suicide. And so when you have a country where there's such a radical disconnect between what people really know and what you're allowed to say in the political process, and it means you can't address problems rationally, it's just exceptionally dangerous. And of course, you can well imagine I think that the Obama administration, they know about the problem, and you can well imagine the political conversations they'd have in-house if they're saying, well, shouldn't we say something? Shouldn't we do something about it rather than just extending all the tax cuts but one? And they're obviously scared out of their minds to do it. This is not the way it always was in this country. I don't want to prematurely, I hope it would be premature, become an old fogey by saying, back in my day. But the fact is, the 1980s were a very different era. I know the pop music may not have been that good, but better, the 70s and 90s were better. But in the 1981, the famous Riverboat Gamble tax cut by Ronald Reagan, gee, maybe we'll cut rates and everything will kind of pay for itself. Well, a couple of points I want to make about that. First is the tax rates before that happened were, by most people's agreement today, too high. They were like tax rates as high as 70%. So it was the direction of the rate cuts was one that probably most people today agree with. The second point is that the Reagan administration claimed this is going to completely pay for itself. When it didn't, what happened? The very next 3 years in a row, they agreed with the Democrats to work on raising revenue and on in connection with, to some extent, with cutting spending or spending growth. So that was an era of reality-based politics and of an era of, to some extent, of course, there was a lot of knife fighting between the two parties and attempts to stab each other, but it was an era when people, to a degree, tried to solve problems and accepted what the problems were, acknowledged what they were relatively honest about it, and actually tried to do something about it. And I don't think anything could be more false than to say that that is the world we're in today. There is actually a prominent Republican, I think his guy named Portman, is running for senator or governor somewhere in the Midwest, and he kind of said, well, you know, we all know that there are going to be tax increases needed. And Grover Norquist, sort of acting like the Pope, said, that is not, he said literally, that is not permissible talk for a member of our party. So that is beyond the bounds of what you're allowed to say. So in that environment, not like the other side is winning profiles and courage plaudits either, is really you can't have a society continue to succeed if there are real problems that everyone knows about and one is not allowed to address them in an honest way. That's just very dangerous.
That's super. You know, I want to ask a question. That's not super, but it's been a super summary of a terrible problem. Clarify that. Maybe I should stop now. So I do want to ask a question, and it is about this elephant in the room, and I'm aware that we have the wrong people up here to address it at some level, especially because, though I don't like these stories about the golden ages either, my instinct is that Dan is exactly right, that fundamentally our politics is just so out of whack that it's a good question how we get it back. And I will point out that we have a forum right after the election on breaking the logjam in Congress, so come to that one also. But I want to ask the political question, because I don't think it's fair to turn it over to questions from everybody else before at least asking each of you to take a minute, no more, to say something about how we make some political progress, what it looks like, what's the vehicle for doing it, that is it the commission, what's the direction in which we can move. So let me sort of go in reverse order down the line here and give you all a minute just to say something about the politics of the situation.
You're
the end of the line.
Okay,
the beginning
good
in
enough.
This case.
Any long-run, viable, sustainable solution to this will be bipartisan. That's the reality. Neither of the two political parties is going to move on this alone. You know, you will often, much of the time, I think, see one party either not acting or making the situation worse. Sometimes you will see maybe one of the parties, could be either one, taking action to slightly improve it. But it's just not practical for there to be a fundamental solution that one party adopts with all the pain that it involves, and then the other party is able to sit back and, you know, beat up on them for it. So we have to have a bipartisan solution. I think that if we have divided government, if we have, you know, the White House and at least one chamber of Congress in the hands of different parties, it creates the possibility for the two parties to work together. There's no possibility as long as one party is in control. The party that's out of power always has the incentive to just sit back and criticize any steps that might be taken by the party in power. I think that's true regardless of which party is in and which is out. If you have divided government, you have the possibility for cooperation on this. You by no means have a guarantee of it. So the hope just has to be that at some point the two parties will come together. The Fiscal Commission could do that. It's unlikely, but it's possible. Back last January, my AEI colleague Alex Brill and I wrote an article calling for there to be a Fiscal Commission because we hope that it would produce that outcome. You know, it still could. I think that at some point the parties will have to start working together. The sooner it happens, the better. But oftentimes these things are done only when there's a crisis or perception of crisis. So I'm not going to make any prediction as to when it happens, but it will have to be bipartisan.
Good, thanks. Diane.
I agree it'll have to be bipartisan, but that's actually not enough because bipartisanship so far has resulted in the kinds of compromises that sound like this. Well, I don't like that tax cut you want, but I'll let you have that if you let the spending that I want in that you don't like. So it's like, instead of mutual sacrifice, what's been going on for the past decade in Congress has been, you get your goodies only if I get my goodies. And that's a recipe for disaster in terms of the deficit. Politicians say these outrageous things that are just factually incorrect because they think it's exactly what the American people want to hear. Like, they think that it wins votes to say, yes, that we can keep cutting taxes. We need to cut taxes more. That'll be better for the economy. Or we need to give $250 checks to seniors because they didn't get a cost of living adjustment for Social Security this year because there was no cost of living increase. We need to give them the $250 extra. We need to keep extending all of the Bush tax cuts. We can afford to do all of this, and I can give you more than my opponent will give you. And that's the kind of talk that we've been having for the past decade, actually. The only thing that will work is, and the reason why Concord Coalition is a grassroots, you know, advocacy group, and we go out across the country, is because until politicians actually hear from the people that vote for them, that they don't exactly believe what the things that sound too good to be true that the politicians are saying, until people express their displeasure of about the federal government overextending itself and treating us like we're stupid. I think the members of Congress and the administration are going to keep proposing these outrageous policies because they think it's exactly what the American voters want.
That's www.concordcoalition.org. Remember when you leave here to go sign up, Dan?
Well, I don't know how much I need to add now before we go to the audience. I'll just say you do need to have both parties being reality-based. And obviously, I kind of feel like I have to take a shot or two at the Republicans here and say, if you don't even accept modern science, in this case, it's really a matter of accepting modern arithmetic. but also, one very dangerous incentive that the parties have is, if you've seen like the Rebel Without a Cause, the chicken game, or if you've done like game theory, the parties have a natural, logical incentive to play a chicken game with each other in the following sense. They're going to have to raise taxes and cut spending, but if you'd rather do more of one than the other, it kind of makes sense strategically to say, I'm going to be as tough as possible, make the other guy give in first. Because I want to get more of my type of change than of their type of change. So it kind of makes logical sense for each side to play chicken games. But the problem is they can really get out of hand. And I think that's really what's happened.
Super. I'm just sitting here actually thinking reality-based politics. What a crazy idea.
I'm wondering if I say there's an asteroid coming, it's going to hit in 5 minutes, if Barry will say super.
Yes.
I always say an asteroid could hit the Earth at any moment, but what can you do about it? But I just read something that, you know, we're actually getting better at that. We may have a forum about that. So we're going to go to the questions. We've got two folks with mics. The rule is we're going to move over there for the first question. And we've got a question right here in the middle. So remember, you're on the air. Stand up. Tell us who you are, where you are in school.
Sure. I'm Tom. I'm a 2L. And so I was just curious, on the political question, do you take any comfort in what's happening in the United Kingdom right now with the Cameron government and that sort of mix of spending and revenue spending cuts and revenue increases? Do you think that's a potential model for us here, or do you think it's just small ball and it's not even up to the task?
Well, I actually think it is a decent model, and I don't think we could ever do it here. But if you look at what they proposed, it's actually quite a balanced package of, you know, tax increases and spending cuts, and they have concern about progressivity of the benefit cuts. If you look at the size of the cut they're proposing, I think it's well beyond what we would need to do in our budget to get us to a sustainable level of deficits. So. But, you know, when I said, when I asked the question to my colleagues, why can't we do what the UK just did? They said, because we need 60 votes to get anything. So, you know, it's like, you know, we don't have parliamentary government. I've always advocated for a benevolent dictatorship, personally, but.
I do think that the UK offers a more promising model than France seems to be offering. So there's a difference in how the two countries are reacting to these things. You know, I think whenever any package is adopted to try to address the deficit, there's always a question, like, is it enough? And I guess one of the other things we should add is that it's unlikely, given how large the long-run fiscal imbalance is, that we'll ever have a single solution, a single package that will address it in one fell swoop to fully close the gap. I think what we'll see, you know, we'll unfortunately have to have a series of reforms, a series of major packages over the decades where we, you know, continue to whittle away at that imbalance. And obviously that, it's always makes the task all the harder, that we have to get the parties together to take action, not just once, but several times. But I think that's the reality that we will face. It is true, it is interesting and true that the package in the UK is mixed between spending cuts and tax increases, and yeah, I think almost any successful package is going to have that characteristic.
There is a danger that in the UK they're going to make they're going to plunge back into recession. The timing of it can possibly be criticized in that way.
Yeah, that's fair.
So right here in the middle of the room, which is where I meant the mic to go. Yep.
Hi, I'm Amy. I'm a 3L. So it seems like everyone's in agreement that we want the Bush tax cuts to get the right level of disposable income and the right amount of revenue raising. So I'm curious what everyone thinks about how to define the middle class, because it seems like maybe that's a big part of the problem.
Yeah, I think one thing that happened here, I don't know if you guys heard about this law professor in the University of Chicago got into big trouble because said despite like a $500,000 family income, he's like feeling very middle class. That reflected the whole optics of, or rhetoric of the thing where you have a basic fiscal situation and President Obama posed the issue of let's extend all the tax cuts but the top bracket on the ground that very rich people should pay more. And so this guy says, and others say, gee, I don't feel like I'm so rich. But the real point, though, is that it's not really just about very rich people. It's about the basic fiscal situation that there is, you know, we're headed for a huge shortfall. And actually, very rich people, whether they should pay more or not, are not going to be paying enough money to really solve the problem. So it reflected the misfocus of the entire. So as I think both of my colleagues on the panel said, the middle class is going to have to end up paying for a lot of this. That's just a fact. It's a fact of arithmetic, really. So this whole thing about who's middle class was really the wrong discussion. It's the right discussion at some point, but not in this case, it was the wrong discussion.
I think it's dangerous to get into this discussion about who should pay and how, you know, if we as Americans recognize that there's a fiscal gap, that we think someone else can always take it, like it's someone else that should bear the burden of it. So, you know, we have this tendency to think about people who are okay to tax are really rich people and evil corporations, as far as I can see so far. And the problem with that is that people won't feel like they have a stake in it. Like, it's going to cause people to get disengaged from the whole issue of the federal budget if they think that what they have at stake is just getting more benefits, but they don't have to worry about the cost of those benefits because someone else will pay the cost. So that's just dangerous, I think, because just like politicians are having trouble weighing, you know, is a program worth the cost, if you disengage a huge segment of the population from having to pay the taxes to pay for these government services, then nobody's going to notice that this is not the right way to decide whether a government program is worthwhile. So that's a problem, I think.
We need Ross Perot again with his charts, I think.
I think the question, I agree with the other panelists, the question of who is middle class in some sense really is the wrong one if it's premised on the notion that we can somehow avoid putting burdens on the middle class. And I guess, and maybe to modify the question a bit, I mean, I think that the key issue with the Bush tax cuts is getting the right balance, not between disposable income and revenue, but between economic incentives and revenue. I think that's the key trade-off. But let me just close with a couple poll results that I mentioned in my article last year as to who is middle class. They went out and asked people, how do you define yourself? And so in one 2008 survey, 2% of the public said that they were upper class. 6% said they were lower class. 19% said they were upper middle class, 53% said they were middle class, and 19% said they were lower middle class. A 2007 poll found 8% to be upper class, 9% lower class, 50% middle class, and 33% working class. So we really have an overwhelming set of Americans who view themselves as either middle class or working class, only the very, very top being viewed as upper class. If you define middle class that broadly, the conclusion you're going to have to put some of the fiscal burden on the middle class really is inescapable.
Good. So I'm going to take this mic and move it over here. And somebody's already got a mic, so why don't you stand up with your mic and go ahead.
Paul McLaughlin, I'm a 3L. I know that the AMT or the alternative minimum tax was a big part of passing the Bush tax cuts. And it was also a big point of controversy prior to the recent recession. But it seems like it hasn't really been talked about very much in the discussion of the expiration of the Bush tax cuts. What role does the AMT play in this whole thing, and what will happen to it if rates do go up, or if they are continued?
Well, that's an excellent question, and actually, there's several excellent questions there. One is like, why nobody's talking about the AMT lately, and I'm absolutely baffled by that. Let's all bear in mind that the permanent AMT provisions in the code would cause roughly 35 million Americans, roughly a quarter of all taxpayers, to actually be subject to this parallel tax system that exists alongside a regular income tax. Nobody wants that outcome, and so year by year, Congress has passed a temporary patch to keep the number of AMT taxpayers around 4 or 5 million. No patch has been adopted yet for 2010. It expired at the end of 2009. And it's not unprecedented to not have a patch in place at this point. The 2007 patch wasn't adopted until December 26th, for example. But what is unprecedented is to not have a patch in place and to have no one talking about the fact that we don't have it in place. So I'm just baffled by that. There will be a patch for 2010. At this point, I don't know if the lame duck session is going to do it or if it will be done in the early months of the next Congress, but certainly an inconvenient way to handle things. So that's a problem. The IRS is going to have to prepare the tax forms for the 2010 tax returns on the premise that the patch doesn't exist because it won't have been adopted yet. The Bush tax cuts have a key interaction with the AMT. The Bush tax cuts largely lowered people's regular income tax liabilities, but did not do very much to lower the liability they would compute under the AMT system. Now, you're required to pay whichever tax is higher. So by themselves, the Bush tax cuts would have roughly double the number of people who are paying AMT. And so the patch has been intended year by year to partly counteract that effect, as well as to counteract the fact that inflation tends to push people onto the AMT. What that means is that if you extend the Bush tax cuts, that in addition to the direct cost of actually extending those provisions, you have roughly $600 billion of cost, $500, $600 billion over 10 years, that in order to provide AMT relief, that the AMT patch becomes more expensive when you have the Bush tax cuts in place. And so that really should be considered part of the cost of extending the Bush tax cuts. Nearly all of that cost is associated with extending the middle class portion of the Bush tax cuts. Most of it is not associated with extending the high income rate reductions.
So I want to sneak in a question, but there's a woman who has a hand up back there and right there, and I wanted the mic to go to Josh right there. So I just want to sneak in a question, which is because I think to tell the whole story, something about balancing the stimulus against the deficit and how we should be thinking about that now. It seems like it's an important part of the story, so somebody wants to jump on that? Yeah.
I believe that we do need to keep some level of tax relief in over the next couple years. My opposition to temporarily extending the Bush tax cuts is not that I don't think we should deficit finance tax cuts over the next couple years. I actually do think that. The problem is that I don't think the Bush tax cuts are the best form of tax cuts in terms of even stimulus. An example is President Obama's own tax policy, which he seems to have abandoned, which is the Making Work Pay tax credit, which is a refundable tax credit. He has proposed in his budget to extend that. It was originally designed as a stimulus provision, but he's proposed in his budget over the past couple years to more permanently extend that cut. He is so busy promoting the permanent extension of the so-called middle-class Bush tax cuts that he has been silent on what is really his own tax policy in his budget, the only piece of the tax proposals that could be considered truly Obama tax policy, and he's abandoned that. But that's an example of a tax cut that, if deficit financed, is actually better targeted to the people that would be most likely to spend that money. It goes to lower income households rather than higher income households. So I actually think that we need some deficit spending to continue over the next couple years. But by 2015, certainly, we should be, there should be no problem achieving the Commission's goal of getting to 3% of GDP deficits by 2015. That would not be harmful to the economy.
So right here, and then we'll go to the back.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Josh Blank. I teach here at the law school, and thank you for this wonderful, I should say super, discussion today. And I'm teaching corporate tax this semester, and so I have a question about the dividend tax cuts. And I heard a little while ago on a cable television news network that'll remain nameless, somebody said, well, the Bush tax cuts were actually really helpful in one way. Corporations didn't pay out dividends before those tax cuts, and after the tax cuts, Microsoft paid out dividends and other corporations paid out large dividends, and we need to make them permanent. And I was skeptical, but I wanted to see what you thought of that argument.
Well, there's a broader issue of what the corporate tax system should look like. And a couple of things. I think most tax policy types are not that favorable about having double taxation of corporate income, where you have the corporation being taxed, and then in the second level, you have distributions to shareholders being taxed at a full rate. So that system doesn't make any sense. It doesn't really make a lot of sense. Addressing it by lowering the dividend rate might not be the very best way to do it, but it was aimed at that problem. A second thing that's probably true is that in the global situation with capital able to go anywhere in the world, it might well make sense in a responsible and financed way to have the U.S. have a lower corporate tax rate than it does now. Although then one thing you'd have to worry about is if the corporate rate is much lower than the rate for rich people, having rich people park their money in corporations so that it gets the lower rate becomes a problem you have to deal with. But the whole idea of doing anything about it to begin with, when we're already have grossly too low taxes compared to what you need, the idea of this other tax cut that might make sense if it's financed almost doesn't really get off the ground. So one point is there are areas where you might want lower taxes, but if the whole thing is too low, you can't even really start thinking seriously about those problems.
Let me just add a few words to that. In terms of whether it increased dividend payouts, there's a number of statistical studies that have been done on that question, and maybe it's no surprise that they tend to get, they don't all get the same results. It's always tricky to isolate these things. But dividend payouts did increase, certainly after the tax cut was adopted, and some of the statistical studies, the majority of them, I think, do find the evidence of a causal impact there. So there probably has been some increase in dividend payouts attributable to the cut, although other factors probably have contributed as well. In terms of what Dan said, I guess I agree with that, and maybe would say it even more forcefully. I think that in the view of international competition, the corporate income tax really will wither away over the upcoming decades. It'll be a slow, gradual process, but we've seen governments around the world, right-wing governments, left-wing governments, socialist governments, cutting their corporate tax rates because of international competition for mobile capital. And that's a trend that I think will continue. And that is one of the forces, I think, that will prompt us to need to increase the role of consumption taxation in our tax system. The individual income tax system will come under some strain, I think, if we try to increase it too much, but the corporate income tax is just especially vulnerable. So I do think the dividend tax cut was not the ideal remedy for addressing the problems of the corporate income tax. It would have been better to have the reduction of the tax occur at the firm level. That would be better suited to addressing the international competitive pressures.
So mic in back, somebody has a mic?
Hi, I'm Kitty Richards, I'm a 3L and I used to work with Diane.
A little louder.
I actually want to push back on the definition of the middle class issue, because I really think that Amy's right and that it's absolutely central to the problems that we have in the political process. Because, I mean, let's just talk about $250,000. That is a number that most Americans will never see. It represents the cutoff point for, I think, the top 4-ish percent.
Two or three percent
of the income distribution. We also live in a dramatically less mobile society than most people in this country believe. You are very unlikely to ever reach that top income echelon if you didn't start there. I think that the fundamental misperceptions about what income distribution in this country looks like, and particularly wealth distribution, drive all of our problems with tax policy. I think that people don't understand that our policymakers are consistently trading off economic efficiency on the order of maybe a quarter point of GDP for systems that are increasingly funneling more and more of the spoils of our economy to a very, very small number of hyper-rich people. Mm-hmm. And you see that if you look at us compared to other nations. And I really think that until we start to talk about what real people, what the typical American family makes, what their tax burden looks like, we're not going to make any progress. And the idea that I'm all for base broadening, it's obvious that it has to happen. But if you properly define the middle class, people who are outside of it have a lot of money. And the idea that we can't raise a fair amount of tax revenue by targeting, you know, maybe the top quintile who have more than half of the income in this country, I think we really need to push back on those things and really need to explain to people and congressmen what the real economic situation looks like. And the tax burden, we also have to think about state and local taxes.
So I'm gonna cut you off with one comment. It was a good comment. I'm not sure I'm gonna say super since it sounds like it's gonna affect my pocket. Anybody wanna comment?
I think you make a very important point. I guess in terms of whether if I or the other panelists are saying something different is that there are different points that may both be valid. I think there's a fiscal gap problem which is not directly about distribution, and money is going to have to come from a broad swath. I think what you're saying is that there is another issue that's extremely important and that needs to be addressed. And that is both the very top pulling away and overall income mobility and income distribution. I actually think that a lot of that has to be addressed on the spending side as well as on the tax side. But I guess I would say, I think you're quite right to say those are important issues, but there's a fiscal sustainability issue and there's a distribution issue. They're both very important. They obviously both interact with each other.
Though I want to, before you jump in, I just want to push you harder, because as I understood the comment, and I'm kind of curious to get more of an answer, I heard everybody up here saying, no, we're just going to have to tax the middle class. That's what's going to happen. And the question or the point I take it to be, well, if we redefine the middle class and drop down from that $250,000 number to people who, I'm not sure what to call that class, the upper middle class, that we would make some progress that way. And I'm just curious if that's true.
I do believe that we need to make our overall tax and transfer system more progressive. So I want to be clear on that. I just don't think the best way to do it is to limit our attention to let's raise the tax rates on the rich. There are so many better ways of raising more revenue from the rich in a way that's more economically efficient. So I would rather see us do away with some very costly tax expenditures, the holes in the tax base, that if we got rid of those holes, if we filled those holes in, we would actually collect a disproportionate share of the additional revenue from rich people, and it would be a more efficient way to raise revenue.
Just a home mortgage interest, for example.
Or the exclusion for employer-provided health care is one that I wish we would do more of in the context of health reform. Also, I won't, on the benefit side as well, there are lots of ways that we could trim benefits that would be progressive. People tend to think that when you propose that we cut entitlement benefits, that we're talking about putting granny on cat food. And it's not, you know, that... There is this group now. Anyway, they greet us often at the Concord events, dressed up as old people with cat food. Anyway, so something grannies, I can't remember. Anyway, so I think there are ways to close the fiscal gap that are progressive and yet are more efficient than the way we tend to propose tax increases or benefit cuts. Secondly, I wanted to make the comment that Americans are inherently optimistic people. It is why we have a huge deficit problem, because we're used to borrowing beyond our means because we think, well, we don't have to worry about paying it back for a while, and my income will be higher by then, you know, by the time I have to start paying that no interest, no money down, you know, 1 year contract on the flat panel TV. I'll have more money once I have to actually start making payments. We're inherently optimistic in terms of timing, like we're very nearsighted because, you know, just live for the moment and everything will be better next year. And we're also very inherently optimistic in thinking about, we can be rich someday. We could be that person that has to pay the estate tax. And so, you know, that's why we get into these discussions when there's no chance in hell that we're going to have to pay the estate tax. We say, that's so unfair. That's so unfair that we tax people when they die. And I don't want that. That's going to create bad incentives for me. I want to get rich. I want to get rich enough to pay the estate tax when I die. And so that's why... You know, 98% of the population clamors for tax cuts on the top 2% of the population because we think we might be there someday.
I think the question really raises some good points. You know, I think actually all of us agree, you know, I'm in a conservative think tank, but I agree that obviously redistribution is a legitimate goal in tax policy, a necessary and essential goal. Obviously, if it wasn't, you know, we could have zero marginal rates on everyone by charging everyone in the country the same dollar tax liability, which would be absurd and appalling. So obviously redistribution plays a role, and it's certainly true that inequality has increased, not just in the United States, but in other countries over the last few decades. I think that the great thing about the way you phrase this is by looking beyond the top 2-3%, because it really is an unviable strategy to say that we're only going to tax that tiny group. And I actually had a blog post a while back just cataloging all the people, left, right, and center, who have acknowledged and recognized that fact. Looking beyond that to the top 20% really is a pretty sensible strategy. On the entitlement cuts, Diane is right. All of the proposals I've seen for major entitlement cuts would exempt people at the bottom. I think that's the right way to go. For example, the progressive price indexation plan that President Bush proposed for Social Security in 2005, which didn't go anywhere, would have completely exempted people in the bottom 30% of the lifetime earnings distribution and been lighter on the people just above that. In terms of taxing the people at the top, I will throw out one thing. People think of consumption taxes as being regressive, and if it's a sales tax or a value-added tax, that's right. But you can have a progressive consumption tax, and the economic costs of progressivity actually are much smaller under consumption taxation. And so if we actually were prepared to switch over from income to consumption taxation, it actually would provide the economic latitude, I think, to collect more money at the top with less damage to the economy.
Do we know how to pick conservatives to bring to NYU or what? So I have a mic here, but before you go, I want to see, are there other questions? Okay, so let's move the other mic over there.
Okay, it's on that.
Stand up and let us know who you are.
Okay, Lee Shepard, and I'm not in work mode. It's on that consumption tax point, and then there's another little point about the people we agree are middle class. For the folks who are paying income taxes, who are not rich, and if we define rich as having investable wealth, okay? Most of those folks are pretty close to consumption tax treatment already, because unless you have hit the limits on the various retirement plans and savings accounts and this and that, that's what a consumption tax looks like. That is the X tax. The X tax is, you know, big deduction for your investments and pension plans and whatnot. So I don't see why we're talking about things like, I mean, I'm for a value-added tax, but, you know, I don't see why we're talking about it, you know, going to a consumption tax when we don't really need to go that much further to get there. Maybe we want to do that, whatever, but, you know, maybe we need to acknowledge that we're 90% of the way to a consumption tax with the individual income tax on most people, and really it's only that slice at the top, and for them I do recommend the New York State system, which is no deductions if you've got a income over $500,000. Then the other thing I wanted to throw out, which is a different point, is that the low end of the Bush tax cuts took, 47% of households out of the income tax entirely. And I'm wondering, do people think that's a little bit dangerous from the long run from a participation standpoint? I mean, if we're worried about people thinking somebody else pays, well, you got 47% of households who have a valid reason to think that. That was it.
Well, they're not paying income tax, but they're paying payroll tax.
But they get that back as an earned income tax credit.
Yeah.
You know, but I'm just talking about the participation.
I'm
going
to move
point,
the mic
the
over
money.
To Jonathan. Thank you. That's a great question.
Let me start, I guess, on the consumption tax point. I don't think we're 90% of the way to a consumption tax. I do think it's certainly true there's a large number of people in the United States who face a regime that in some ways is similar to consumption taxation, but the bulk of the savings that finances capital accumulation in the United States comes from the people who do not face that regime. And so also the tax-preferred savings accounts are really a very awkward, imperfect, and inefficient way to get to consumption taxation or to approximate it. They, you know, the savings has to be for particular purposes. You can get a tax break simply for moving money into an account that you would have, out of some other account instead of actually doing new saving. You don't have corresponding provisions on denial of interest deductibility, which would be part of a self-consistent consumption tax structure. We also have provisions in our tax system that go beyond a pure classical income tax and put a greater burden on capital accumulation. You know, we have the estate tax, again, a similar thing. Tiny fraction of the population is affected by the estate tax, but a significant portion of capital accumulation is coming from that group. We do have the corporate income tax, which is an additional burden on capital accumulation. So I think we are not at all close to a consumption tax. We're largely in an income tax mode with some provisions that almost combine the worst features of both income and consumption taxation. I do think it's a concern, the 47% who don't pay individual income tax, which is actually a joint result in 2009-2010 of the Bush tax cuts and the Obama tax cuts, the making work pay credit. That number will go down a bit if making work pay credit expires. But I do think that's a concern. I guess one advantage if you did go with a value-added tax is that you would then have a liability beyond payroll taxes that people are visibly paying.
We tend to talk about consumption taxes every few years. It comes up as whenever we think, gee, we should be doing something more fundamental to fix our tax system. What's different this time around, because of the concern about the fiscal outlook, is you're going to hear, and you may have already heard a lot of people talking about a value-added tax, not as a replacement for any portion of the income tax, but as an additional new tax that the U.S. federal government would rely on for revenue, simply because we need to think beyond the typical revenue revenue neutral tax reform, we need to think about revenue gaining tax reform. So that's something that is different. There are a lot of people who advocate not just broadening our existing income tax base to raise revenue, but also thinking of new tax bases. Besides the value added tax, you'll hear a lot about environmentally motivated taxes like carbon taxes.
Good. I think there's a mic somewhere over here. Yep.
I am Dan Atuel. I was wondering if you could fact check the competing talking points about the effect of the upper tier repeal on small businesses, and how much is that just a political thing, or is it going to have a real effect?
There's a version of the small business argument that is correct and a version that is not. There's a bipartisan tendency to think that small firms are inherently better than big firms, and so any initiative that people want to support, they say that it helps small business, whether there's a basis to it or not. I was talking to a non-economist friend of mine recently and who supports extension of the Bush tax cuts, and he said, why don't the Republicans say that this is going to be a small business tax increase if we take away these rate cuts at the top? I said, well, I don't know if there's been any Republican who's talked about this issue for more than 30 seconds without the word small business passing through their lips. So I think it's not as if that argument is being neglected. Here is the reality, I think, is that if you allow the high income rate reductions to expire, you are increasing by several percentage points the effective tax rate on investment in the economy. Investment done by large firms and investment by small firms. Investment by pass-through firms, sole proprietorships, partnerships, and S-corps, because of the higher ordinary income tax rates, and investment by C-corporations because of the higher dividend and capital gains rates. And so that's the true statement. And it's also true that a significant volume of investment will be affected by the expiration of the high income rate cuts, even though only 2 or 3% of the population is impacted, because they supply a large portion of the savings to finance investment. In fact, roughly half, 45 to 50% of the income of pass-through firms goes to people who would be affected by the higher rates. And the fraction of investment by those firms that's being done on behalf of those owners are probably similar to the 45 to 50%. You often hear this talking point that only 3% of the owners of pass-through firms would be affected. That's true, but of course it's irrelevant. Counting the number of owners, the number of firms, that is meaningless. The question is the volume of activity. When that point is made, though, the rebuttal is often put forward, well, if 3% of the owners of all pass-through firms actually account for 45 to 50% of the income from pass-through firms and the corresponding share of the investment, then the income and investment there must be very concentrated. So in fact, a lot of these pass-through firms cannot be all that small. And that's quite correct. Many of the pass-through firms whose owners would be affected by the expiration of the rate cuts at the top are actually large pass-through firms, which economically is fine. So I think it's important to not get hung up on small business arguments or arguments about firms of a particular size. The focus should be on the fact that investment will be subjected to a higher rate for firms of all sizes. Of course, investment is also adversely impacted by the deficit. Again, comes back to my point, worst of both worlds if you do a deficit-financed extension of the middle-class tax cuts while letting the high-income ones expire.
It's an empirical question. When it comes to tax rates and economic growth, it is an empirical question that Alan just hinted at, in that if you lower marginal tax rates and you reduce tax revenue, you don't make up for the lost revenue by raising revenue in some other way. You have to weigh the increased private sector economic activity from reduced tax rates against the decrease in the public sector component of national saving. So national saving is what helps economic growth, and it's the sum of what the government saves and what the private sector saves. So that's why it's not a slam dunk to cut marginal tax rates, and therefore economic growth will go up, national saving will go up. It may not go up. In fact, we've often experienced in the past that when we lower marginal tax rates, that private sector activity does not go up by as much as public sector savings goes down, and that's when you get into trouble, because national saving falls, and that's harmful to long-term economic growth. So that's why it's an empirical question. It may be bad, it may be good for economic growth. It depends on how big the incentives are from the private sector perspective versus the cost to the deficit.
I think we have time for one more question right there. Gentleman in the blue shirt has the last, well, the last question, not the last word.
Hi, my name is Malik. I'm a student undergrad and an employee here. I actually just wanted to touch on a couple of the things that the two of you just mentioned. There was a CBO study that was done in 2009 that showed that tax cuts only stimulate, if you give a dollar of a tax cut, you get back, I think, around 30 to 50 cents on that dollar, whereas opposed to if you collect those taxes and you put it back into things like infrastructure, into things like state and budgets and so forth and so on, you're getting around $1.30 to $1.70 in revenue. So I'm wondering, A, why we continue to talk about tax cuts as the only way to really stimulate the economy, rather than actually taking the taxes that we had even in the 90s when the economy seemed to do okay, and plow that back into the country. I mean, we have situations like what happened in Minnesota where the bridge collapsed a couple of years ago. You know, what's the economic impact on the local economy when you see local infrastructure falling apart?
I'm going to interrupt with A because we're going to run out of time. So the question is, does the tax...
I think it's widely agreed that in terms of stimulus, tax cuts, especially these types of tax cuts, are not the right way to go about it. That public spending, infrastructure spending, if there are good things that are sufficiently shovel-ready and the like, handing money to poor people or unemployed people who are more likely to spend it, those do clearly provide more stimulative bang, and that's just clear, I would say.
There's a difference between if you're talking about short-term economic policy, fiscal policy, which is designed in a downturn like we're in to increase demand for goods and services, and because we have idle capacity, we have unemployed workers, we have abandoned buildings, so you need to stimulate demand. Longer term, you need to increase productive capacity, and that's about increasing the supply of capital to the economy, labor supply. So there's different, when we talk about tax cuts being good for economic growth or lowering marginal rates being possibly good for economic growth, that is more of a long-term, increase labor supply, savings, investment kind of argument. When it comes to stimulating demand, you're right that tax cuts are not the best way to get people to go out and buy goods and services.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. My article about the Bush tax cuts, I consider three bad arguments for the high income rate reductions that are being put forward. One is the focus exclusively on small business. The other is this argument that 250,000 is not all that rich. And then the other is the argument that this is a good way to provide a Keynesian demand stimulus. As the CBO report and anybody else will tell you, the high income rate reductions are lousy demand stimulus. And this argument for them has to be providing incentives for long run growth.
Let me just offer one last word, a proposed last word, unless someone else has it. Apparently, President Bush, the second President Bush, met with Milton Friedman at some point when Friedman was still alive, and he was hoping Friedman would be friendly, and said Friedman just glowered at him and said, "To spend is to tax." And the Bush administration passed talking about tax cuts and small government giving the money back to you. They passed a Medicare prescription drug benefit that had an estimated long-run cost of $20 trillion. That's a $20 trillion tax increase. They just didn't say how they were going to do it. They just had to leave it to someone else.
That is the last word, though I have the last word. And I have two things to say. First, a reminder, next week's forum is on the NYPD stop and frisk policy and generally the issue of racial profiling. We have a great panel. We've got Dennis Parker from the ACLU and Heather McDonald from the Manhattan Institute and our own Andy Schaefer, who happens to have a day job with the NYPD. So I think that's going to be a great forum. And the second thing I want to say is super. This was really, really great. Thank you all.